For over 35 years, Dr. Ken Dychtwald has been recognized as the foremost visionary and original thinker regarding the lifestyle, financial, healthcare, and marketing implications of the longevity revolution. He is a psychologist, gerontologist, documentary filmmaker, entrepreneur, and best-selling author of 16 books. Dr. Dychtwald has shared his vision regarding the impact of an aging population and the transformation of retirement in live presentations to over 2 million people. His strikingly accurate predictions have been regularly featured in leading media worldwide. Dr. Dychtwald's article in the Harvard Business Review, "It's Time to Retire Retirement," was awarded the prestigious McKinsey Award as the best article of the year. Among his many prestigious awards, he also received the 2013 National Leadership Award from the American Society on Aging. Since 1986, Ken Dychtwald has been the founding president and CEO of AgeWave, a firm created to guide Fortune 500 companies and government groups in product service development for boomers and mature adults. He has shared his insights as a delegate and featured presenter at the World Economic Forum in Davos, Switzerland, and at two White House conferences on aging. Dr. Dychtwald has also been a highly valued advisor to many of our nation's top political and social leaders. As America ages, every aspect of our society will be touched. However, it is the face of retirement that will undergo the greatest transformation.
AgeWave is on the pulse of what we believe is the most meaningful demographic shift in the history of our country. The implications for every one of our clients are enormous. Partnering with Ken Dychtwald and AgeWave gives our FAs a greater ability to help their clients live their very best lives in retirement, and helps our firm gain advantage in an industry racing to serve the booming retirement market.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Ken Dychtwald.
Always great to be here at ASA. This is probably my 39th year as a part of this association, and it's my favorite of all. So a few years ago, I'm not a real wild football buff, but I was at a conference and I happened to sit next at dinner to one of the other speakers, Joe Montana, the great quarterback. And I said to him, I said, Joe, so I couldn't think of what to say. I said, Joe, so what's the secret of being great at what you do, being a great quarterback? And he said, Ken, it's really simple. You have to throw the ball to where the receiver is going to be. If you throw the ball to where the receiver used to be, or you throw the ball to where you are, you might look great on camera, but you'll get no points on the board. So the whole trick is to try to figure out where the receiver is going to be, and that's where you aim. So do I know the future of retirement? Of course I don't. But I have been thinking about this quite a lot for the past 40 years, and we've been doing quite a lot of research on this subject. And what I'm going to try to do during my 45 minutes here is to weave together five themes and to try to share with you what this might look like. Everybody ready for that?
Yeah.
All right, great. So there are five converging forces, and to me, they all kind of stitch together. Let me break them into pieces. First, as you've heard many times, we are in the midst of a longevity revolution. Throughout history, humans have been searching for fountains of youth. There have been all these theories and ideas for how to rid the body of its impurities, from the alchemists to folks who believe that if you took baths with virgins, then you would never get old. And I think that's still practiced in Washington. I don't know if it's a I don't know if it's working, but it was the beginning of the 20th century and the arrival of public health departments that changed the future of retirement and the field of aging. The emergence of antibiotics. How many of you know what this is a picture of? Right, iron lungs. If I went to the high schools in your communities, I guarantee you not one person would have any idea what these are. Thanks to the Salk vaccine that came along and took this disease and rendered it a thing of the past. Oh. And the 20th century was filled with extraordinary breakthroughs in the way we managed and distributed food. The breakthrough in refrigeration, which came out of a nerve gas from World War I, amazingly was used to apply to the ability to keep foods fresh in our own homes. Watch The Honeymooners if you ever want with Jackie Gleason. He had no refrigerator. It was an ice box, and there was an ice man in the 1940s that would come to your house and deliver ice from time to time. Extraordinary suite of pharmacologic substances, a better understanding of how we care for our own bodies and each other. And out of all of these miraculous breakthroughs came an alteration in our life expectancy. This is a chart of the past 1,000 years, and what you see is that up until the 20th century, by and large, most people didn't age, they died. So in the 1850s, couples didn't say, gee, honey, what would you like to do in retirement, because you'd be dead. Our medical system didn't need to be expert at things like hypercholesterolemia, osteoarthritis, adult onset diabetes, or dementia, because people were inclined to die young before they got old enough to have the diseases of aging. The length of time it takes for the traffic lights to change was geared to the swift movement patterns of young people. The chairs you're sitting on were designed for the backs of young people. I'm sure you've already noticed that. The auditory range in our public address systems and our phones are geared to the ears of the young. And even our notion of who we are in life was sculpted to match a world in which living to 50 or 60 or 65 was considered that's what life is. The time beyond was rare. I'm going to click this device and show you the average life expectation worldwide over the past 100,000 years. And here the story gets for me quite majestic, because medical anthropologists now tell us that throughout 99% of all the years that humans have walked this earth, the average life expectation at birth was under 18. And so we see that throughout all of history, there have always been 40 and 60 and 80-year-olds, but not very many. But because of these breakthroughs in medicine, we now have a horizon in front of us that humans have never contemplated before. And so everything we do in this field is being done, in a sense, at the very front end of an evolutionary path that's been going on for 100,000 years and is now beginning to alter everything in the world, including retirement. Two-thirds of all the people who have ever lived past 65 in the entire history of the world are alive today. So when people say, well, what's the future? The future, is it high tech? Is it, you know, robots? Is it, yeah, some people believe that. I think this is a picture of the future. When this picture appeared in the New York Times, I was taken by it because the gal in the blue dress, Sarah Knaus, she was 118. Sitting across from her was her daughter, Kitty. She was a mere 95. Standing up in the back was her young grandson, Bob. He was just 73. Next to Bob was the great-granddaughter, Kathy. She's 49. Down on the lower right is the great-great-granddaughter, Christina. She's 27. And little Bradley made up the sixth generation of the Knaus family. This is the most extraordinary thing that's ever happened. I believe the longevity revolution, in its own way, and how it affects the family, and how it causes people to think about living a long life, and how it changes the relationship between generations, and what it forces to have happen in the medical field, and what it makes us think about in our communities, will have a greater impact at the end of the day on all the dimensions of our lives than either the industrial or technological revolutions of previous centuries. The longevity revolution is non-trivial. It changes everything. One of the pieces that changes is, well, if we're living a bit longer, and every year, decade since 1900, the average life expectancy is elevated between 2 and 2.5 years, so it just continues to creep forward. Well, when are we old? We still use the number that was picked in the 1880s, 65, which by itself is an interesting question. We don't use any other measurements to measure things that have changed. You know, when I was a kid, gas cost 17 cents, you know. We don't use that measurement to measure the price of gasoline anymore. It's a different era. But 65 was selected by von Bismarck. Well, what does 65 look like these days? Well, Sophie Loren was 65 when this picture was taken. To give you a frame of reference, when Whistler painted his mom, she was right around the same age. So this is it's kind of a multiple choice. And I have to tell you, when John Glenn announced he was going up into space at 77, everybody stopped and thought about that, because that's retirement land. 77-year-olds are doing quiet things. They're not being astronauts. Now, I know Glenn. I've testified before beside him in Washington. He's a very tough guy. So I was asked by CNN to provide commentary on air about what I thought about him going up into space at 77. So to prepare for that, I watched him do his first day of interviews. And a lot of young reporters were kind of poking at him, and they were saying, you know, what's a guy your age doing? Isn't this a publicity gimmick? And what's the big idea? And Glenn responded. He said this. He said, hey, just because I'll be 77 doesn't mean I still don't have dreams. I tell you what, that really got me thinking. Because I think in a young world, in a short-lived world, we believe that young people have hopes and dreams. That's the province of youth. And then you either fulfill them or you don't. And by the time you're 50 or 60, you're either happy with how it turned out or you're not, and it's time to, you know, go quietly to the sidelines. Well, maybe one of the things that changes if we live a longer life is that 60-year-olds have new dreams, and 70-year-olds maybe write their first book of poems, and 80-year-olds decide to come back from a stroke and make themselves better again, or people who have not behaved in a responsible way grow up. Or maybe somebody falls in love at 52, or maybe a 95-year-old, you know, you might have just seen there's this chic gentleman from Asia who's 102, just finished his last marathon. And, you know, with no gait problems, just ran a marathon and didn't start running until he was 70. So this is the new frontier. The land of maturity is the uncharted, unlanguaged, untapped frontier of this new century. Madison Avenue has begun to take notice of this. Here's an example.
One morning, I woke up and I knew you were really gone. A new day, a new way.
Robert, it's not too late to change your mind.
No, my bags were packed.
Go.
Second force that's at play is the, well, if people are living longer, where do we put that longevity bonus? And I would tell you that this is a non-trivial theme too, and I think it's one that we in the aging field don't always think about in the way that the public is thinking about it. Historically, life has been organized partly to fit into a 50 or 60 year lifespan. We learned, we rested, and we died. And we had some leisure. So I have pictures. The idea was that education was for the young. You can't teach an old dog new tricks. And then the idea was you'd fall in love and it would last till the last breath you took, till death do us part. You divided up the responsibilities. Honey, I'm going to do this. You'll do that. We'll get the babies made. We'll, you know, make some money. We'll retire. And then right before you died, you took a cruise, and that was the package. Now, I know I'm oversimplifying, and I apologize. But here's an interesting question. If you knew that you might have an extra year or five or 25 of life coming your way, and you knew it now, and your only responsibility was, a reflection, was to think about, well, where would you put it? You probably wouldn't put it at the end. You know, you probably wouldn't say, I'm going to wait until I'm a little bit bored, and maybe I'm incontinent, and I'm short on cash, and a lot of my favorite people have died. And I'd like 15 more years of that. What's happening in the public, and it's happening in every community, in every family, rich people, poor people, every color and persuasion, are saying, you know what? If I'm going to live a longer life, I want to distribute that longevity bonus. And that's exactly what's happening. What you're seeing is that informed by longevity, rather than having more old people being old the same way longer, the whole life course is redistributing, is rethinking itself. And so 40-year-olds are going back to school thinking there's time. And people are retiring and saying, I don't like this, and they're starting encore careers. And people in bum marriages are saying, I'm gonna have the love of my life by getting out of this first marriage. Or people who are just unsure of who they wanna be are stopping to say, in this longer life, there's time, even for second chances. Third, so it's not all wonderful and sweet, and there are incredible possibilities informed by extra longevity to alter the way we live our lives, but we're also in the middle of a financial mind shift, and I don't necessarily think it's easy for people, but I don't think it's bad. Here's where I think the root of it is, and I know that we often think it's about government things and principally entitlements. I actually feel that the bigger shift had to do with corporate pensions. It was the case that pensions were set in motion as a way to keep loyalty with workers and also give them a late life, a base of security, both in terms of their health and their cash flow. And there was always believed to be this three-legged stool, you know, your own saving, your pension, and your and what you might receive as an entitlement. From government. And so let's just look at this leg of the stool, which people often don't talk about. The defined, guaranteed pensions have basically been eliminated. And they got switched because companies had to put them on their balance sheets. And because of the aging of their workforces, the unfunded liabilities were so substantial that they figured out this way to create these sort of 401ks, DCs, and tell people, you know, this is your own thing, do it yourself. And the stock market was getting 10 to 15% returns those years, and people thought, this is great, I'm going to be a millionaire. I'll do my own thing, it's portable. And so what you saw is a rise of a different kind of a pension where the responsibility was on the person. At the same time, How are we in terms of our discipline around savings? Really bad. I mean, this is not 401k specific, but man, oh man, you look at all these countries of the world, and we are really, really bad. And when I saw this chart, I thought to myself, where have I seen this pattern before? Here's where I saw it before, obesity rates. It's the same thing. So what do we know about Americans? We love being free, and I do too. And we love having our own choice and control over things, and I do too. But man, when it comes to long life, 80, 90 year, managing your health, managing your money, we are terrible. And that's very dangerous. Because one leg of the stool knocked out. At the same time, there's all this volatility and all this fear and all this anxiety and who's looking out for me? And when people are losing their 401ks now, because that's what they have to rely on, everybody's kind of in the stock market through these new pensions, it's retirement that gets knocked away when some of that money goes away. Or even worse, most people don't even put their money in their 401k. And the leakage, that is people breaking into their 401k because they want to buy a flat screen TV or somebody's gotten sick, is 75%. On top of that, and by the way, am I a Republican? I am not. Am I a Democrat? I am not. Am I an independent? I am not. I just don't line up with the party thing. I try to look at issues and think about what matters to me, and as a person who's interested in gerontology and demography, let's look at 1940 to 2010, just the facts around the equation of Social Security. I'm not even going to look at Medicare today or health in this session, but I know it's profound, but at least for today. So the life expectancy at birth has gone from 63.6 to 78.3. The life expectancy, more importantly, at age 65 has grown 50%. It's gone to 18.7 years. That's a lot. The average retirement age, you all ought to appreciate, was 70 for 25 years after the passage of Social Security. People actually wanted to keep working because they wanted to earn some money, and they also like working, and it made them, you know, connected with other people. There was this fluke, and I really do believe it was a fluke, that for about 30 years, people thought they should retire younger and younger and younger. And the best way to guarantee yourself a solvent retirement is to be part of a very small generation, to get yourself born into that, okay? Be well thought of by the public, and give birth to twice as many kids as you are. It works, okay? But the average retirement age for a short while dropped way down to 63. The population of 65-year-olds plus was 9 million. It's now 38.5 million. The ratio of workers per each recipient was 42 to 1. The first year that Social Security was paid out in 1940, it's now 2.9 to 1. The number of recipients went from 222,000 to 54 million. The average payout went from $220 per year to $12,892 a year. The total payout from the federal government went from $49 million to $696 billion. And the percent of our budget, federal budget, that goes for paying out Social Security went from 0.04% to 19%. Now, I don't know about you, but it's clear to me that this extraordinarily important institution was crafted during a very different period of demography and population equation. I don't know that it's going to be flush for the rest of my life. And when I get off a plane in Kuala Lumpur or Kyoto or Singapore or Beijing, it doesn't matter where I go in this world, Mexico City, same things are going on. So it's hard for me to say it's a political party that's at hand. Demography and longevity are altering these relationships and equations and straining things. And that 2010 was before this happened. This was the 1950s. These were the changes in population growth. You could see that in the 1950s, the big growth was the arrival of the baby boom. The 1960s, teenagers. The 1970s, the 1980s, 1990s. Here's the decade we just came out of. And here, when I click this device, is the way population is rearranging in America during the years 2000 to 2020. So all of that strain on Social Security is before the boomers started turning 65. I hope that they remain in place, these entitlements. But man, oh man, there's going to be a lot of strain. So we've done surveys now all over the world at AgeWave, and they're representative surveys, which means we don't just talk to rich people or poor people or Democrats or Republicans. We work with Harris Interactive with the oversight of Humphrey Taylor, the chairman of the Harris Poll. Humphrey's 83 and is kind of my Obi-Wan Kenobi in the area of public surveys. And this is one survey we did for Chuck Schwab, where we wanted to see how each generation viewed where they're going to get their retirement funds. And the silent generation still believes sort of three-legged stool: personal savings, employer pensions, Social Security. You jump down to boomers, and boomers are less likely to be comforted by what their employer is going to do for them. But then you jump down to Gen Xers, and they don't think that either the government or the employer population is solid as a rock for them. And you go to millennials, and they kind of believe that this is going to be my responsibility. Which brings to mind another issue. And Maggie Kuhn was mentioned earlier, one of my dear friends and one of my very special mentors. Maggie always talked about, we put too much attention on independence. It's really all about interdependence. And I think one of the things that's happening with regard to this financial wake-up call is that families are turning to each other again. If you can't get a loan from the bank, or if you've lost your job, well, what do you do? Well, you turn to your brother, or your mom, or your kids, or your cousin. And that's okay. You know, we think that's a bad thing, but you know, families and communities are supposed to help each other out. So I think this is what families are beginning to look like. It's not a sandwich anymore, sandwich generation. It's like a cube. And usually there's a woman in the middle. Most of the family managers in this society are not men, they're women. So let's just say her name's Kathy, she's in her 50s. Kathy's doing fine, but her daughter just got divorced, and her daughter and her daughter's child need to move back in with her. Well, that changes her retirement plan. And she's got a son who, let's just say, is not all he can be. And mom and dad are still alive, but she's helping to support them. And she's got her mother-in-law is in assisted living, and she was stunned to discover that Medicare didn't cover much of that, and so she's also helping out with that. And she's got a brother in construction, and his business is up and down, and her sister's a doctor, she's doing okay, but the family is trying to hold itself together. How many of you are in families like this one? Right, we all are. Fourth, I think there's a new lifescape emerging for retirement. You know, you go to Webster's Unabridged Dictionary, and you look up the word retirement, which I have, and it says to disappear. Which, I'm not making it up, to go away, to withdraw, that's sort of the default position. I don't think the boomers dislike the idea of living a long life, but I don't think they like the current version of aging. And is that good or bad? I don't know. Each of you will make your own decision and choices in your own life, but I think boomers want to do something slightly different in that stage of their lives. So a few years ago, I had written, I don't know, sort of my 12th and 13th books about retirement, and I was being hailed as somebody who, you know, had some ideas about retirement. And I thought, there's something missing here. And what I thought about was back in the 1970s, one of the people that I was on the road with a lot for presentations was Elizabeth Kubler-Ross. And when she was crafting her stages of grief and bereavement, all around death and dying issues. And Elizabeth, you know, was brilliant because she constructed these stages. And I thought, well, how come nobody's thought about the stages of retirement? So our firm, AgeWave, in partnership, in this case it was with another firm, interviewed thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of people at all stages before, during, and after. And we came to the conclusion that there were five stages of retirement. First stage we named imagination. About 15 to 5 years before retirement, people are busy with other things. They're not really thinking about their maturity. I wish they were, by the way, because if they were financially, they might be more likely to support themselves. You know, I was friends with Ram Dass early in my life, and he had this whole be here now theory. And as a psychologist, it's a great way to think about the world, you know, not dwelling on the past or worrying too much about the future. But as a financial strategy, it's like a disaster. So the earlier one thinks about one's old age financial well-being and takes action, the more likely you can have an effect. But people are not really thinking much about retirement in that way out. But interestingly, 88% of people expect to be happy in retirement, and 75% expect to achieve all their retirement dreams. And 44% feel on track. They're not. Then about 5 years before retirement, it's sort of like microwavable popcorn. Everything starts to sort of pick up. People think, wow, I'm going to be retired in a few years. What am I going to do? What games am I going to play? Where am I going to visit? Oh, I'll be able to sleep late. I hate to go into a blue zone here, but what retirees generally do in the first 2 years is get way involved in porn sites on the internet. So I know we don't have a session on that here at ASA, but that's the actuality of it. But what am I going to think of and make friends? And it's fantastic. And people start to imagine where they're going to. By the way, there's nobody they really have to talk to about this. You know, before my kids went off to college, there were seminars at their high school on college life, and they went and visited colleges, and they went to websites, and they are live cams. And then all of a sudden, people are being told in 5 years you're going to be retired. Good luck. Who do people talk to? Who are the guides? And 91% of people expect to be happy in retirement. Now, let me tell you, half of these people have never been happy. So there's this, we have this sort of mass delusion going on, you know, like television ads and Money Magazine, retirees, they all seem happy. And so you can be miserable, but man, you get retired and just happiness will overcome you. And then there's a third stage. We called it liberation. It begins on retirement day, which is really quite a grand experience for people. And people really do feel fantastic. This is great. I'm free. I've been waiting for this. I've lived to experience it. Decades of freedom in front of me. I'm having a great time. And we were really curious to see how long it lasted. Average was 1 year. And then the fourth stage sets in, reorientation. Who am I now? I kind of miss those people I work with. I don't know how to work this computer thing, this new download iTunes. I don't know, they upgrade like every hour or two. And used to be I'd ask the young people in my office, now I don't know, what am I doing here? And I seem to be going back to the supermarket every day. And like my father, who I'm dearly in love with, I'm not even gonna put my clothes on today. I'm just gonna wear my pajamas this week, you know? And it's like, so people have to think about, who do I wanna be? And you know what? A lot of people find themselves unhappy with retirement. It's not all it was cracked up to be. They feel a little bit not used well. They feel a little bored, a little unstimulated. Last year, the average retiree watched 49 hours of television a week. And people start to get nervous. Whoa, maybe I don't have enough money. Everybody I'm talking to has got a disease. Maybe I'm gonna get those diseases. You know, and I talk to people who are in the business of creating these great health websites, and the way it works when you're retired is you have any condition, a little rasp in your throat, your toes a little sore, you get on the internet, cancer. You know, you find a way, you got all that free time that, cancer, I may have cancer here. We haven't really dealt with the side of, and I'm talking about the representative of the total population, not particularly rich, particularly poor, all of, what do people do with that time? Are we meant to be leisurely for a quarter of a century? And then the fifth stage, late 70s, early 80s, reconciliation. People try to come to terms with who they are, who they've been. There's a turn towards the spiritual. A lot of worry about running out of money, outliving your money. Sadness, appropriately, due to loss of people you have loved, and concern about leaving a legacy. So we've just done many, many surveys now. What represents the ideal plan for, we've asked boomers, for the next stage of your life, and what they say is, only about 30% say, what I'd like is to never work again. I want to stop working and be done. Nobody really wants to work full time. By the way, I've given talk to college campuses, and the young kids, they don't want to work full time either. So people talk about part-time work or even kind of creating a new balance. Maybe I could be a mentor. Maybe I could downshift. I don't have to make as much money, but I kind of want to be involved. You know, I can maybe get involved in charitable things, or maybe I need to earn money, so maybe I could, you know, work from 10 to 2, which is like what the McDonald's greeters have done, or the idea of finding more flexibility. And then we asked boomers, so if you're going to work, and 70% want to work in retirement, need to be clear about that. It's not. We've asked these questions so clearly now of about 50,000 people, not will you be forced to because of cash shortages? That's another question, and yes, a lot of people will. What's your ideal? What's your dream? 70% of boomers want to work at least a number of years into retirement. But you know what? They want to do something different. I'm tired of being an accountant, or I'm tired of running this senior center, or I'd like to be a musician, or I'd like to have a coffee shop, or maybe I'll be a high school teacher, or. And so all of a sudden, there's this vast opportunity for the education world, community colleges, for people to teach folks how to reinvent themselves. We just did a survey where we asked people, at what age did you expect to retire 10 years ago? And partly because of the volatility of the last decade, but also because people are starting to think about, I don't know if I want to have 25 years of non-work. And by the way, unless you're Bill Gates, you can't afford that. People are pushing back their retirement by 4 or 5 years. Now, if boomers and people a little bit older decide, I'm gonna work a few extra years, that has repercussions. So I was giving a speech last year, and I always get people pushing at me, you don't know what you're talking about, or have you thought about this? And Jack Welch and I were in a discussion, and he's a sophisticated, savvy older guy, and he said to me, what's the effect of people staying at work longer on employment? Check this out. Between 2006 and 2011, there were 4 million more people over 55 in the workforce. People who otherwise were slated to retire said, I'm going to stay a while longer. And I can tell you this, that if those 2, 3, 4 million people had retired early on schedule, President Obama would not have had the unemployment challenge he had. The There are repercussions to people staying at work longer. Some are good, some are bad. You have mentors, you have older friends, older bosses, generations come together. But there might be people who feel that you're in the way. We got a chance to watch this played out on television last year. Boomers versus
Xers. I just want to say, I couldn't be happier. You were the only choice. You were the perfect choice. You have been an absolute gentleman in private.
Less than 1 year after Jay Leno handed The Tonight Show off to Conan O'Brien, NBC decided to cancel Leno's disastrous primetime show and move him back into his old time period at 11:35 Eastern. Conan's Tonight Show, which was losing badly in the ratings to David Letterman, was to be bumped back to 12:05 the next morning.
Hello there, I'm Conan O'Brien. Sorry if I'm a little late. I had a job interview at Lady Foot Locker.
You know, I can't tell you how much I enjoyed your participation in the Jay Leno scandal.
They called and asked me to do his show.
That's right, and then you went on and did the 10 at 10.
What's the best prank you ever pulled?
I think the best prank I ever pulled was I told a guy that 5 years from now, I'm going to give you my show. And then when the 5 years came, I gave it to him, and then I took it back almost instantly.
Wow.
But Jay, Conan and I have children.
Oh, I'm sorry.
All you have to take care of is cars.
That's right.
I mean, we have lives to lead here. You've got $800 million. For God's sakes, leave our shows alone.
I don't think Jay was happy because he went on the Oprah show and said, I sucker punched him. I didn't feel like I did sucker punch
him,
but then I looked it up in the dictionary, and it turns out I did.
Yeah, but...
So I think there's a new definition of retirement emerging. I think people want to stay connected. I think we've seen enough retirees who are just adrift, and people want to be more connected. College towns, I think, are going to boom. I think you're going to see people trying to reinvent themselves. Who can I be next? And what people really would like is a little more freedom. Freedom to reflect, freedom to sleep, freedom to play, freedom to write, to read, and freedom to maybe work. Takes me to my last theme and with which I'm going to tie all this together. I think partly what's been missing in these last 50 years is that we've done a lot to try to concern ourselves with the financial or physical well-being of older people without giving much thought to, well, what are they supposed to be doing with their lives? What is the purpose of longevity? It cannot be simply to be try to be young longer, and it can certainly not be to watch more television. So we did a survey of 20,000 people in 20 countries, and this will be a hard slide to read, so I'll interpret it. We gave people choices in countries, Russia, Mexico, Egypt, China, Turkey, all over the world. And we found that the beginning of the end notion is not the way we in America view retirement, or the UK, or Indonesia, or Canada, or France, and so on. Time for rest and relaxation, those countries that are just coming up out of their third world status and are beginning to develop still believe in retirement the way we did in the 1970s. Time to rest, it ought to be entitled. But if you really want to see the future, countries like the United States, Canada, UK, France, Sweden, Germany, China, who have experimented with retirement the longest, are now discarding it and saying, this ought to be time for a new chapter in life. Winding down, going to the sidelines, maybe it's good for a break, but I want to be a functional, productive person. I think retirement is becoming many things, with a sort of a fantastic mosaic, a time perhaps for more free time, to play a little bit, to have fun. And by the way, I would say we in the aging field are take everything very seriously. A lot of people are trying to figure out how to have fun again. I mean, we just recently put together an analysis of the leading experts in research in the entire field of aging. And one category was fun, and there were no experts. Loss, dementia, nostalgia, fear, frailty, thousands of people. Fun. Time for relationships, either with friends, with family, for new friends. Retirement could be a time to keep learning. You know, I think the boomer generation particularly love to learn. They're going to want learning to be a core part of their lives. Maybe a time to re-career. But I think most importantly, people are thinking about living this last stage of their lives, not in a kind of a mindless, entitled, leisurely retirement. And I am being a little bit judgmental of that. I think there's too much of that. I think people want to think about, what can I do with this stage of my life that's perhaps my highest purpose? I feel that in my own life. I'll be 63 in a couple of weeks, and I think, you know, I've only got so much time left. There's an urgency. I really want to, everything I do, I want it to be more important. I don't want to work all the time, and it's not just about work. It's my seeing my mom and dad. It's about, you know, it's about my kids, about my time with my wife. It's making new friends, the importance of living with purpose. When Katrina hit a number of years ago, I had a book coming out, and the whole PR tour got smashed because of this horrible storm, as it should have, but I'm watching what's going on in New Orleans, and it was like horrendous how we were not there for these people. So I decided I was going to donate all of the earnings from that book to the rebuild of New Orleans with Habitat for Humanity, which is not the point I'm trying to make. The point was I got into a phone discussion with Jonathan Reckford, the chairman of Habitat, and he said to me, Ken, I think there's a lot of people your age going through what you're going through now. And I said, what's that? He says, you know, you got that gnawing feeling. I said, really? What gnawing feeling? He said, you know, you're trying to make the transition from success to significance. I don't think he's wrong. What can we do in our later years that's not self-indulgent, but contributory? And at the end, what could 75 look like? It might be this. It might be that. And my last clip, one of my favorites.
I run 17 miles every morning. People ask me how I keep my teeth from chattering in the wintertime. I leave them in my locker.
So here's what I'd like to say to close. First of all, very grateful to Bank of America Merrill Lynch for what they've done to sponsor this session and all the things that I know will be coming forward in the years to come having to do with an entirely new understanding and appreciation of the challenges and possibilities in people's lives in retirement. Thanks to ASA, who always gives me room to try to stretch myself. And I'd like to say to you that we are at the dawn of a new era. This third age, where all of a sudden people are going to be thinking, who can I be next? How can I afford it? How do I stay healthy? What's my role in my family? What's my role in my community? And I would like to feel that if we can beat some of the challenges, the problems, the poverty, the dementia, the illnesses, the absence of integration of our healthcare system, I think that we're at the dawn of an extraordinary moment where people will have the chance to live long lives and perhaps reinvent themselves several times and hopefully make great contributions to the world from their later years. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.